The next unit of this section, we are looking at impurity functions. And these impurity functions are used to make two decisions. Either decision is, the first decision is whether we should continue to split, and then we are using them as well to decide upon the split criterion. This is the most important decision we make in constructing this decision tree, because here we have a chance of minimizing our errors, or coming up with a criterion to minimize our errors upfront. Looking at a decision tree and its leaf nodes, we can look at a certain leaf node here, and the split of the examples that is assigned to this leaf node. Again, let's look at the illustration. So here we have a certain leaf node, for example, this one, and to this leaf node we have assigned a split of the training data. This one. When should we go on to split? Should we or should we not go on to split? And for this, we can again define a number of criteria. We could argue about the size of the split of examples. If, for example, there are only a handful of examples left, even if they are from different classes, then maybe we say that we do not want to further split the feature space more, because we may not expect many more different examples in this part of the feature space. We could and will, of course, look at the purity of the example set, which is perhaps even more straightforward, and say that if we have a pure example set, of course, we do not have to further split the examples. Although we might do so, because there might be examples in the split which have different characteristics still for other features and could be further split. And of course, as before, minimizing the size of a decision tree, we want to minimize its weighted external path length or external path length, and further splitting means just increasing the external path length, increasing the complexity of the rules that we have. So this might also play into our decision. We might define a threshold, and once that the size of split dt falls below the threshold, we stop splitting. We might stop splitting if all members of the split are of the same class. Seems straightforward. And applying Occam's razor as a rule, we and this is perhaps the most useful part of this, although the other ones are also applied in practice, is to ask whether we actually improve the decision tree. For example, by looking at the misclassification rate or the misclassification costs. If by further splitting we have no chance of improving the decision tree, then it stands to reason that doing so will not help us to create a better hypothesis. And we should maybe stick to the hypothesis that we already have. Let us look at an example again. Here we have two decision trees which are supposed to decide four classes, C1 to C4. We have a color coding of the classes here, and the decision trees are assigned splits of the example data, or an example set which have an equal distribution of the four classes here. Let this be the root node and this be a split of the examples. Now we can try and compare these two situations and come up with an idea of which one is better and which one is worse. It would appear that if we look at the left splitting, we will be able to make distinctions between certain classes, but not others. So we are able to distinguish C1 from C3 and C2 from C3 and both of them also from C4. So we have these distinctions can be made. These classes can be distinguished from those classes using the left splitting. In the right splitting, it's not quite the same. We can not distinguish C1 from C2 at all in this case, but also not in this case here because they are still in the same class. Sorry, I forgot to mention that here. We cannot distinguish C1 from C2 and C3 from C4 using this splitting. In this splitting, we can distinguish C3 from C4. However, we fail to be able to distinguish either C1 or C2 from C3 or C4 because by accident, half of this ends up here and ends up here. Which splitting seems better up front? It might be the left one because we can make more decisions. But if we take again into account that we might also have misclassification costs, and if that is our rule, then we should also consider this one and see whether it may be more important to distinguish C3 from C4 than it is to distinguish the other classes from each other. All of this is also again written down here, just for completeness sake. And what we need is a measure of helping us make this decision. We need a measure of impurity. And in order to define such a measure, in order to come up with such a measure, we need to decide upon certain properties the measure should have. And basically, it should be able to make a decision for every possible comparison of subsets that we might find for a certain splitting. So we define an impurity function, iota, as follows. We have a number k in n, and an impurity function is a mapping of the interval 0 from 0 to 1 in k dimensions to the real numbers, where the preimage, this, is a k minus 1 simplex, which I will get to in a minute what it actually is. And for this mapping, we want to have a certain number of properties. These here. We do not say how the function will work, but we say what we want from the function. So what is a k minus 1 simplex? Here we link Wikipedia for you for simplicity. And perhaps we might take a look at this image here. Here, if we say we have three classes, we might have a situation where let's not talk about classes. So we have if we set k to three or k to four in our case. Then we have a situation that we end up on each axis with a point. And the simplex is basically the simplest possible polytope or basically shape that can be constructed in this dimensional space. So I go a bit up here and we can construct a simplex very simple by looking at zero dimensions where a simplet corresponds to a point, one dimension where a simplet corresponds to a line segment connecting two points, two dimensions where a simplex corresponds to a triangle and so on in higher dimensions. And this is what we basically see here in this image as well. Let us quickly go back to So it is basically a construction of a geometric shape that we are doing here, and we have certain requirements that we want the impurity function to have. We want the iota function to become minimal at any point that corresponds to a unit vector in this space here. So at any point that corresponds to just one of the different dimensions, to have a value of one and all other values are zero. So these here. We further want the function to be symmetric with regards to its arguments p1 to p2, which means all these k value p1 to pk, which means all these k values, whatever their ordering, whatever their permutation, when they are put as arguments to a iota function, they should result in the same function value. In this graph, we are not looking at function values, we are looking at the pre-image, at the shape that is constructed by this, by this interval to the kth dimension. And finally, we want iota to become maximum at a point 1 divided by k, so where every p value here is of the same size. Looking back at our example, if we have this splitting here, just for this node, we see that every class here has the same amount of examples, which would correspond in our discussion here to this situation. But let's not jump ahead. This definition is just a definition, the generic definition of a function which we call impurity function. You can define any other function that you want, which accomplishes such a mapping, and which will not be an impurity function if it does not fulfill these three properties. What we are doing here is what is called an axiomatic definition. These are our axioms that we want to be true, that we desire to be true for a function to be called an impurity function. If you give me a function for which I can show that one of these properties or more than one is not fulfilled, it is not an impurity function. So we are seeking for a function that has these properties, and it will become clear in a minute why. Looking closer at our, so as you saw, we make no reference here to any decision tree or to any classification problem or anything whatsoever. We just give pure mathematical objects and define properties that they should fulfill. Here, we draw a connection to what the classification situation that we have. We have a feature space X, we have classes in that feature X, K classes to be exact, and we have an ideal classifier that maps the feature space X to C, and we have an example set D, which is basically a subset of the Cartesian product of X and C. This is what you already know. This is just a short rendition of what we have seen right at the beginning in the setting again. And we are given a function iota, which is supposed to be an impurity function, just as per our definition from before. Then we say that we can basically overload or introduce what is known in programming as polymorphy. We introduce a different argument to the iota function, which is then just the example set D. And if we say we want to compute iota of D, what happens is that we go through all classes C1 through CK and compute their relative proportion of examples belonging to classes C1, C2, C3, and so on until CK, and use those as arguments P1 through PK, as given here. So what iota gives us, or what this construction gives us, is a way of calculating the impurity of an example set that is assigned to a node, like the impurity of this example set that is assigned to this node, which would correspond to D, or of this split of an example set which is assigned to this node, which would be d t if that node were t. If we had a function that gave us, going back to these properties, or perhaps no, if we stick to this for a minute still and now go back to this, if we now know that these values p1 through pk, which are the arguments of function, basically all the values that go into the arguments here, are basically the relative proportions of the different of examples of the different classes in the example set D, then we can already see that if we have such a situation that all classes have the same proportion, look at this example again, where this is the case, that yes, this is maximally impure as per our intuition of impurity. So none, this node, if we assigned a label to it, we would not know which class label to assign by the majority vote, because all examples have the same amount, all classes have the same amount of examples. It would be basically a random decision among these four classes. Of course, if we have a cost measure, then things look different, but even then, it might turn out the same. So now it becomes also clear why we want the function to become minimum if our arguments look like this. This would be p1 equals 1, so this value p1 equals 1, and all other values p equals 0, which means here we have only examples of class 1 in the example set, but no examples of another class. This would be maximally pure. This would be an example like we saw here with these leaf nodes. These are maximally pure ones, these four. This one not, it has different examples from two classes, but these are maximally pure. No, here we are. So these properties of an impurity function are what we want to see, what we want to have. And perhaps it's also clear now why the order of the arguments is unimportant, because in the end, we did not define which is our first class, or which is our second class. It's just arbitrary how we labeled them here. We can mix them around and the result would still be the same. We do not want to have an impurity function that tells us this tree is better than that tree because gray comes before yellow in some labeling. This does not make sense. The trees are the same because we do not have an ordering among classes which have been assigned to the same node. So it cannot be that if we call a Yoda function and somehow these values get flipped around or permuted, that the function value that we compute is different. So what Yoda gives us, we have not yet seen a specific Yoda function, mind you, we've just talked about the properties of the function, how we want to use this function in order to measure the impurity of an example set D. But we have not yet decided, or we have not yet come up with a function that actually does this. And before we do that, I want to first show you how we want to use the Yoda function in order to make a decision, in order to, or better yet, in order to tell us whether we improve a decision tree by introducing a splitting. So what happens to the to this decision tree when we introduce this splitting into the decision tree? Do things get better or no? And this is what we want to measure by looking at the delta Yoda when we compare the original example set with the splitting of the example set as introduced by some splitting criterion. And all we need to do in order to compute the delta of the iota, so the reduction, hopefully, so it cannot increase, it can only be reduced, or it can stay the same. We compute the iota of the original example set, the impurity of the original example set, and we compute the impurity of each individual split from the splitting. J goes from 1 to S. And this impurity value is then weighted again by the relative amount of examples found in each split, which is given by this ratio. All of this summed up and subtracted from the original impurity of the original example set gives us the reduction of impurity that we would see when we introduce the splitting or when we introduce this splitting. So all of this was, it was a bit of abstract, I give you that. It will take some time to wrap your head a little bit around this, although, but I think it is, it will become a little bit more or much clearer even when we see a specific example of an impurity function that, for example, we can base on the misclassification rate. The link is broken, apparently. I will try and fix that. Let us go here. So, in this case, the misclassification rate with regards to a certain node T. We are looking at this now. So, 1 minus the maximum, 1 minus amount of the maximum amount of correctly decided examples in a given split. So we define an impurity function by using the misclassification rate, and we do so at the moment now only for two classes, which are represented by these two values, P1 and P2, as per our previous definition here. So we compute for class 1 the relative amount, and we compute for class 2 the relative amount. But basically, wherever these values come from, these are just the relative amounts of the two classes. And we use basically 1 minus the maximum of this of either class, of the maximum relative amount. This P1 corresponds precisely to what is computed here. Compare these formulas and compare the computation of P1, which is given here again. You see, it's exactly the same. All these grayed out ratios are just relative amounts with regard to some class, usually in the formulas. So they look a little bit long, but they are not really complicated. So this gives us the misclassification rate with regards to the maximum class, which will be the label of that class. I'm a little bit lost right now. I'm sorry. I might have made an error in saying this falsely. No. It is a bit different. We are not measuring the misclassification rate because at this point we are not comparing with the label. We are just using the same ratios here So we are basing this on the misclassification rate formula, but it is not the same as measuring the misclassification rate. Rather, we measure the impurity of in a two-class situation of a given data set by just looking at what is the least amount of examples that are not classified, that will not be assigned the majority label. If, for example, we use the majority label classification as is given here. I'm sorry for that I assigned this wrong. In the misclassification rate, we assign labels by using the maximum class, and therefore the impurity of the impurity depends on the minority class, and this is basically what we compute here. What is the amount of examples, relative amount of examples that are in the minority? Sorry for this mistake. I hope you will not pick it up wrongly now. Please take note of this. We can rewrite this in terms of not looking at P1 and P2 and computing the max of the two values. We can also say that we can only look at one of the two because these values sum up to one. So if we take the relative proportions with regards to each class, class one and class two, then of course the entire examples that we have will be, or the sum of this will correspond to the entire example set that we have with two classes. So we can also just say the impurity with regards to these two relative proportions is either the value P1, if the value is smaller or equal to 0.5, or 1 minus P1 otherwise. Because 1 minus P1 gives us P2 and vice versa. So you can also substitute P1 for P2 here. It gives us just the same. And here, the alternative rendition of this impurity function, if we do not have these kinds of arguments pre-computed, but just are given an example set, just as we also defined before, we can compute the max out of the relative proportions with regards to our two classes, C1 and C2. See a question in the chat. Could you please re-explain why it shouldn't be P1 if... So if we look at how we assign the label to a node with using the misclassification rate or based on the misclassification rate, our vote here, our vote of confidence is basically the majority class is assigned in any given situation. So if we look at our illustration again, here for this particular node, we assign yellow because more examples, if we take relative proportion here as number of examples, more examples are from this yellow class C1. This is then our label. So this is then the label that is assigned. And if we then want to look at not purity, but impurity, we have to, of course, or a way of measuring that is to look at the remainder. So the majority class is, if P1 happens to be the majority class, so if P1 happens to be the label, or if class one happens to be the label, therefore if class one happens to be in the majority, therefore class one becomes the label. Therefore, this P1, which is basically computed, this ratio is larger than P2 in a two-class situation, then the minority would be all examples which are still part of this splitting, which are from the C2 class. And this gives us an idea of the impurity of the node. Let us look at a graphical representation of this. So to explain the graph, on the x-axis, we see only P1 at the moment. We do not see P2. Why is that the case? The reason for this is because we are in a two-class situation in a one simplex, k minus one simplex, which means if we go back here and if we go back to the definition of simplex and the construction here, a one simplex is a line segment. Perhaps a bit more visual would be this. A one simplex is just a line. A two simplex is a triangle. Three simplex is a tetrahedra, and so on. But a one simplex is just a line. And let's go back to the graphical representation here. We therefore, or therefore, the we do not have two dimensions here. The second dimension is folded. And we indicate this here by P2. If the ratio of examples from the first class, P1, is close to 1, there are very few examples from P2. And the closer P1 gets to 0, the more examples are there for P2. Therefore, it suffices to have just this two-dimensional plot where the x-axis gives us basically the representation in a two-class situation. So the relative ratio of examples from class P1, from class 1, class C1 or class C2, and the resulting impurity value, iota, that we would compute using this formula. So if we have an start with 0, P1 equals 0, it means P2 equals 1, it means the impurity is 0. Similarly, if P1 is 1, that means P2 is 0, the impurity is 0 again. This is good because it fits our desired property that whenever we have a pure situation, 1, 0, 0, or 0, 0, 1, or and so on, dependent on the number k, in our case, in the example case below, k equals 2. So 1, 0, or 0, 1, then iota should become minimum. And here, apparently, the minimum is 0. For any value or distribution of examples in a given split of the example set that is in between these extremes. So for any distribution where P1 is bigger than 0 but smaller than 1 and P2 is correspondingly 1 minus P1 or also bigger than 0 and smaller than 1, the dual of the P1 value in the two-class situation, we get one value on this curve. And at an equal distribution of examples, 0.5, P1 equals 0.5, and therefore also P2 equals 0.5, we get the maximal function value iota, the maximal measurable impurity. Let's check again with the properties. Iota becomes maximum at the point 1 divided by k for all classes. If we have k equals 2, we have two such values in this tuple, 1 half and another time 1 half equals 0.5. So going back here at 0.5, at 1 half and 1 half, this equals 1. 0.5, I'm sorry. This is the maximum value of the iota function. There's one property that we haven't checked yet, namely, is iota symmetric? Can we, can we permute these arguments and still obtain the same iota value? We can double check also in our graph, visually inspecting it. At least in a two-class situation, we will find that this is the case. Because if, for example, P1 has 0.75 proportion, we obtain this iota value. Now we know that P2 is 1 minus 1 minus P1. And if we just flip P1 and P2, so if we just flip the two in this argument call, this would be then P2 and this would be then P1. We would simply end up here, which is also 0.25. So yes, there is a symmetry around this, around the apex or around the maximum value, maximum x value, the x value where iota becomes maximum, and we can just fold this and see that there's a symmetry here, very obviously also. So we can generalize this function very easily to more than two classes, to k classes, which would then fit our general setting, having k different classes to classify. And we just say, okay, in this regard, what is then the impurity would then become, what is the impurity with regards to the misclassification rate is then 1 minus the maximum class, because the maximum class is the one that we assign here. So everything else, examples from all other classes that are still in this splitting, would then be counted as adding to impurity. Now, this of course can be then transferred again to the overloading of the function with a different parameter d, which then just looks the same as before. So this is all very consistent with the previous conditions. What happens if we use this in practice? So this impurity function, although this, once you have thought it through again and again, it becomes very clear and straightforward, although you may consider this construction I would be okay if you said this was complicated. It is a bit complicated. However, it is also very precise, and I hope that by going through this one or two times, or a couple of times even, you might find this to be good because of its precision. Or easily to follow because of its precision, and not because everything is just set in well, ambiguous terms and high language only. This impurity function has problems. And the first problem could be that if we now compute delta iota, now as a reminder, delta iota is the impurity reduction when we want to find out whether a splitting makes sense or not, whether the splitting reduces the impurity that we will have. These delta iota values may be zero for all possible splittings with some likelihood. Not always, of course, but it may be the case. And this is given by this can be perhaps illustrated here a little bit. So if we have a situation where, for example, we have a point here on the curve and a splitting which suggests that we get one split here and one split here, then the weighted average that we compute may, dependent on the relative proportions, end up with the same overall impurity. So remember how delta iota is computed. We compute each impurity for each split, weighted by its relative amount, and then subtract that from the original iota value. And it may just happen to be that in the end, this term ends up the same size as this term, because we end up having a situation where we, yes, we get a little bit more pure situation here, yes, we get a less pure situation here, and we may end up with a situation where this ends up the same value as before, therefore giving us zero iota. And this, of course, can be done with many combinations of different features when we look at the straight line of possible iota values here. And we want this situation to become less likely, because it really is a problem with the misclassification rate. It does not occur always, but it may occur, and because of how the function is constructed, there's a slight problem with the construction of this function, which we will see in a minute when we look at a different kind of iota function, impurity function. This situation can be avoided to a greater extent. Second problem with this impurity function is that it underestimates pure nodes, which means that the splittings that we might obtain here in this example A versus example B, So we might prefer a worse splitting over a better splitting with this impurity function, simply because the impurity that we measure here is assigned to a value of zero, which is of course the impurity that we wanted to be assigned. However, if we compare these two situations and actually do the math, we will find that for the left splitting, we get the same impurity, the same delta impurity, as for the right splitting. Because here, the fact that the right node has an impurity of zero cancels out this amount from the relative proportion. And therefore, what we are left with, if it's just this, which does not look very pure by comparison, gives us basically the same delta impurity here. So we, although this situation looks better, we have at least decided a part of this class better than before, we end up in a worse situation here. In order to remedy the situation, and I know I'm running a little bit out of time, I will go a bit over time, if you don't mind. Just to get through this, since we are now deep in this at the moment, and of course, since there's a recording, you can always look at it later again. We define a variant or a subset of impurity functions, which we call strict impurity functions. So we are given an impurity function as defined before, which is supposed to fill all its properties as before, and we then say we have two argument sets, which we are now here denoting as fat P, which corresponds basically to the vector of these argument values, basically. And so we have two of those, P and P prime, which are all from the same simplex. And we call this impurity function strict if it is strictly concave, which is accomplished if we change the desired property C from the original definition, so this property here, to this property, which looks a bit more complicated. So we have an inequality here, and we say that the impurity of a linear combination of these two argument sets here, meaning two different kinds of example sets, for example, should always be bigger than the linear combination of the impurity values which can be computed for each individual set of arguments. If the linear combination is if the lambda value used for the computed linear combination is between 1 and 0, so it cannot be 0, it cannot be 1, then it can be equal. And of course, if the two values, the two argument sets are different. Look at Wikipedia again for a quick illustration. So concavity is probably a well-known term. So we call a function concave if it has a curve function like this, if it has if basically the point of concavity is that we have this shape of a function. Although very important to notice, this function is also concave. However, strict concavity makes the further requirement, and this is given by this is given by this particular rendition of the requirement, and also given by this particular rendition of the requirement, that for any two points on the curve for which we compute a weighted average, the average point will lie always below the curve, regardless of which averaging lambda, or in this case, averaging lambda we use. And this way we can make sure, or we can avoid the situation that we have always a zero for all possible splittings, if we have an imperative function of this sort. Based on this requirement of strict imperative functions, a lemma can be proven, namely that a strict imperative function which is applied to a splitting d1 to ds from an original example set will always yield a delta iota of greater or equal zero, where equality is only given if and only if the relative proportions of the examples from different classes in D correspond exactly to the relative proportions in each and every split. Otherwise, we will end up with a delta iota greater than zero. Again, all of this is written here again. So, coming to an impurity function that fulfills the strict impurity function requirement, we use the concept of entropy. Entropy comes from information theory, and it is based in probability theory as well. And we introduce now entropy first in an abstract sense again. So, cut away everything that we know at the moment about decision trees. We are just looking now at a very abstract situation from probability theory and compute the amount of information that we can get from this situation. And this is then called entropy. So we have a certain event, and we have a probability of that event to occur. This is PA. And per definition, the entropy of that event, which can also be called self-information or information content, is measured by the negation of the base 2 logarithm of that of the probability of the event. If we have an experiment which gives us k different outcomes, a1 to ak, so outcomes in this regard are the same as our events, k different events as outcomes, then we can measure the mean information content of that experiment, and we denote this by h of a here, and call it Shannon entropy as follows. The Shannon entropy, h of a, can be measured as the base 2 logarithm of each individual event that might occur, weighted by its probability. All of it summed over all k events, and the negation, which is actually part of computing the individual entropy or the self-information of an individual event, is simply put in at the beginning. Keep in mind that probabilities are between 0 and 1. Therefore, the logarithm, if you know the logarithm function, is will compute a negative value. This is why we negate this here in order to get a positive value out of this. So the smaller the occurrence of probability of an event, the larger its entropy. And whereas if we have an event that always occurs, even in an experiment. So if in this experiment somehow event A1 always occurs and none of the other events that we that could occur occur actually, then this experiment in general and this event in particular has zero entropy. So no information is in it, because we do not need to explain a lot in order to convey the fact that either this or that event might occur if always the same happens. We could just say, we could just make the prediction that always the same happens, and therefore there's no information in it. To understand the concept of entropy a bit better, you could consider the amount of yes and no questions that you need to ask and get answers to in order to decide which of these events need has occurred when you are given a random run of this experiment. So how many questions do you need to answer? Or to put it closer to computer science, what is the amount of bits? So yes, no bits that we need to encode the occurrence of a certain event. What is the least amount of bits that we need? Based on that, we can define what is called the conditional entropy, and on top of that, the information gain. We have an experiment which has again A1 to AK outcomes, and we have another experiment B which has B1 to BS outcomes. And the conditional entropy of the experiment A, given the outcome of experiment B, is then defined as basically, again, the here conditional entropy of the experiment A, given that a certain event from the occurred in experiment B, given the probability of that event occurring, and that all of it summed over all possible events of over all possible events or outcomes of experiment B, where the conditional entropy of experiment A, given a particular specific event of experiment B, is then defined as follows. The base 2 logarithm again of that probability, of the conditional probability of a given a certain event occurring in experiment A, given that we know that BJ occurred, and that again weighted by the same probability and negated. So in more abstract terms, or in plain language, we ask, how does the entropy change if we learn something about experiment A by conducting experiment B? If we want to transfer this now a bit more clearly, directly to decision trees, what do we learn, or how does the entropy change when we go through a decision tree? At the beginning of a decision tree, at the start, when we start looking at an example, we know nothing about the example. It's just any example. So there will be some information, some entropy at this point. But once we look at the first feature, and this could be then our experiment here, we know something about the example, and the relative proportions or the probability of the example belonging to either one class, yes or no, changes because of this knowledge. And this is basically what is expressed by the conditional entropy, or measured. How well does, let me go back here, how well does looking at a certain feature of an example when we want to classify it, basically giving us a random possible feature value, inform us about the label that is to be assigned to a certain example itself, when these are the possible labels. Just as before, so here you could see the connection of the Shannon entropy to the conditional entropy by just leaving out the conditions here, right? And based on the conditional entropy, we can now define the gain of information that we get by conducting experiment B when there is some relation to experiment A. We just compute, just like with the delta impurity function, we subtract the conditional entropy of experiment A given B from the Shannon entropy of experiment A, which is then here given by putting the formulas here. Again, all of it is written down here again, just so that you can follow up later. Now we want to define an impurity function on that, based on that again. And we call this the impurity function based on M entropy. We start with two classes again, P1 and P2, encode the relative proportion of class 1 and class 2, and we just use the Shannon entropy, compute the Shannon entropy directly here. So base 2 logarithm of P1 weighted by P1 and base 2 logarithm of P2 weighted by P2. And this can, of course, again be extended to an example data set as given before. So this just for consistency and completeness sake. So this is just the overloading of the same function. Here we can see the graph of the entropy. Just as before, we can compare to misclassification. Why doesn't this work? That's odd. Sorry that the jump is not perfect here. This is a problem with that particular way of doing this. I will try to fix this. Yes.
Okay, to quickly interrupt, Martin, yes, to answer the question in the chat. Yes, there will be a lab class, and yes, we will discuss exercise sheet 3.
Yes. I will come to an end very quickly now, and sorry for overrunning for a quarter of an hour, but I think since we were very in-depth into this, it did make sense to finish this properly now, so that you have a full picture in one row and can then later, of course, go through it again. So here, if we compare the two function values, we can check the same properties again as before. And here we see that this is a concave function. This is also a strictly concave function as per our requirement, because regardless of which two possible points we choose here for our splittings to compare, the weighted average will always be a value below that, which, if we look at the misclassification, it looks better if you jump on it with an Acrobat reader. So if you compare this to the misclassification based function, then you see that here, especially if we have function values that are on the same side of the symmetric function here, there is a higher chance of ending up with an average that is basically the same as before, thereby rendering delta iota zero difference here. And this situation is remedied by this function. Of course, it still may be the case that we end up with splittings that on average then give us a zero delta iota in overall. However, much, much less likely. Here we extend the whole thing again to more dimensions. We take a step in between with three dimensions, so don't get confused. This is a three-dimensional, or this has three class in a two simplex. So here we have two dimensions for the simplex, so which gives us a triangle as per the simplex definition. And here on the y-axis is the entropy or the iota value that we give, and it gives us also a nice concave, strictly concave shape. And for k classes, it looks again like this. Basically, the entropy function here. So if we want to compute delta iota or delta the delta impurity or the impurity reduction, we can basically align this function directly with the conditional entropy that we have seen before. So this is again a reproduction of the delta iota function when employing the entropy-based impurity, or when plugging that into the function. And we can see here the alignment between the two. And I will not go through this in detail. I've said it before on a previous slide, but if we now look at what could be experiment A, what could be experiment B, we see that there's a one-to-one correspondence between the two, so which gives us this correspondence between information gain and delta impurity. So experiment A, just very short, is the classification, and experiment B is evaluating an example with regard to a feature. Evaluating an example with regard to a feature gives us information that makes, if the feature is worthwhile, the solution of experiment A, classifying an example, easier. There's a third one called the Gini index, which I will not go into this time, also not next time. We will skip that entirely. So this basically concludes the unit on impurity measurement. And next time we will move to how to employ these functions in constructing a decision tree. But this is basically the most complicated, or in quotes, complicated part of the decision trees. And as I said, I hope, and we are striving for giving you the most precise possible rendition of these concepts and connections between these concepts, and not in order to make an easy thing complicated, but to make to give a precise definition of what is going on with decision trees. Because if you read the books, even if you read the Mitchell books, he will gloss over certain things, but just by talking about them. And once you get to implement a decision tree, or once you want to understand other people's implementations of decision trees, you will end up having to learn this definitely. Don't worry about the lecture. We will not ask you for proofs of these kinds of things. Look at the exercises, and you will see, get a much better idea of what exam questions might look like about this. Thank you very much. And I guess this concludes the lecture for today.
Someone's asking to please repeat the last sentence about the exam.
Yes, it will be part of the recording. So, but don't worry that we will not ask you to do very complicated proofs in an exam. We will ask you for conceptual information. We will ask you for that you understood the connections that we have drawn here, and that you can apply them on reasonably sized examples which are fit for an exam. And as I said, look at the exercises, practice this in a sensible way.
Okay, then, since there don't seem to be further questions, I will say thank you, Martin, and take over the screen share already. And we will then take a quick break before we move on.